इस गुजरात साहित्य पर्व में एक अपनी बहुत प्रिय पुस्तक के बारे में बातचीत करने को, एक अपनी बहुत प्रिय लेखिका के साथ हूँ और एक ऐसे मित्र के साथ हूँ जिनसे मेरी मैत्री पिछले वर्ष दोबारा शुरू हुई इसी स्थल पर, और बिना समय का अपव्यय किए जो मुझे लगता है कहना ज़रूरी है कि कई बार ये परिचय में बात कही गई कि नमिता जी जयपुर लिटरेरी फेस्टिवल की संस्थापिका निदेशिका हैं। मुझे लगता है ये उनके साथ बड़ा अन्याय है। जब आप जयपुर लिटरेरी फेस्टिवल के साथ उन्हें जोड़ते हैं तो लेखिका के रूप में उन्होंने जो कुछ किया है उसको हम एक तरह से भूल जाते हैं या बीरबल की छोटी लकीर कर देते हैं। मुझे लगता है कि उन्होंने अपना पहला उपन्यास, अभी हम लोग गिनती कर रहे थे, कोई 35 साल पहले लिखा था और वो इट वॉज क्वाइट अ सेंसेशनल नॉवल। इट वॉज रिव्यूड वेरी वेल इन टाइम्स लिटरेरी सप्लीमेंट एंड इट वॉज प्रेज स्काई हाई बाय खुशवंत सिंह, वेरी डिजर्वेडली सो। और उसके बहुत बरस बाद तक उन्होंने दूसरा उपन्यास नहीं लिखा। जब दूसरा उपन्यास लिखा तो वो भी मेरी निगाह से बहुत पठनीय और सराहनीय था, मगर उसकी उतनी आलोचना समालोचना नहीं हुई। मगर अभी जो उन्होंने पुस्तक लिखी है वो मुझे लगता है कि बिल्कुल एक अद्भुत पुस्तक है। और जब मैंने उसे पढ़ा तो उसका शीर्षक है थिंग्स टू लीव बिहाइंड, तो मुझे लगा कि पुस्तक कम से कम ऐसी है विच इज़ नॉट टू बी लेफ्ट बिहाइंड एनीवेयर, क्योंकि उसको आप जितनी बार पढ़ते हैं उसकी एक न एक परत खुलती है। संक्षेप में पुस्तक आप पढ़ेंगे आपको उसका आनंद आना चाहिए। मैं उसका कथानक आपको नहीं बताना चाहता हूँ, मगर हम पहाड़ी ब्राह्मणों में कुछ एक विचित्र बात है कि हम सब लोग आपस में एक दूसरे से रिश्तेदार होते हैं। अभी हम यहाँ आ रहे थे तो ड्राइवर ने पूछा, नमिता गोखले जी आप मराठी हैं? तो उन्होंने कहा हाँ मूलतः तो मराठी हूँ, मगर मेरा सरनेम जो मराठी है वो मेरा शादी के बाद का है, उसके पहले मैं पंत थी। तो ड्राइवर जो प्रवासी मराठी अहमदाबाद में था बड़ा प्रसन्न हुआ, उसने कहा एक ही बात है तो आप दो तरह से मराठी हैं। और वो और खुश हुआ जब उससे कहा कि मेरे साथ जो बैठे हैं ये मेरे मौसेरे ममेरे भाई हैं और ये भी पंत हैं। तो इस पुस्तक में दो तीन बातें ऐसी हैं जो मुझे लगता है कि अखिल भारतीय पाठक के लिए समान रूप से रोचक है। आप कहेंगे गुजरात का हिमालय से क्या रिश्ता है, उस उपन्यास पर हम चर्चा यहाँ क्यों कर रहे हैं। इस उपन्यास की कथा संसार जो है वो समय, वो 1857 के स्वाधीनता संग्राम की पहली चिंगारी से 10 वर्ष पहले का पहाड़ है, और जहाँ कहानी समाप्त होती है वो प्रथम विश्वयुद्ध के पहले का पहाड़ है। अब पहाड़ दुर्गम है, वहाँ काका कालेलकर ने हिमालय का प्रवास किया था लगभग उसी समय जो इनका कथा संसार है, 1899 के आसपास। उसके कुछ वर्ष पहले दयानंद सरस्वती जो गुजरात के सुपुत्र थे उनके प्रभाव से समाज सुधार का एक आंदोलन हुआ था, और इनके उपन्यास में अ कॉन्स्टेंट स्ट्रीम जो धारा है वो कास्ट सिस्टम की है। छोटा पहाड़ी परिवार है, पंत, जोशी, तिवाड़ी, पांडे अल्मोड़ा में रहते हैं, ये सब के सब बाहर से आकर बसे हैं, कोई 300 साल, 400 साल, 500 साल। गुजरात से ही वहाँ शाह परिवार आके बसा है जो क्षत्रियों और वैश्यों के बीच की भूमिका निभाता है। और कहीं ना कहीं इस कहानी में अंग्रेज़ों के आने के बाद धर्म परिवर्तन है, उसके साथ आधुनिकता का आना है, पश्चिमी शिक्षा है, आज़ादी की लड़ाई है। और मुझे इस पुस्तक में जो सबसे अच्छी बात लगी है, जो मैं चर्चा करना चाहूँगा उनके साथ भी, त्रिदीप भाई के साथ भी, कि एक सीमा रेखा जो अपने मन में होती है कथा साहित्य की और इतिहास की, वो धुंधला जाती है। आपको पढ़ते पढ़ते समझ में नहीं आता कि ये पात्र कमिश्नर रामजे, ये तो एक ऐतिहासिक पात्र था, ये कॉर्बेट जो था वो ऐतिहासिक पात्र है, मगर एटकिंसन का गैजेटियर वास्तव में एक दस्तावेज है, मगर जो कहानी में इन्होंने उपयोग किया है वो तथ्य भी है और वो चरित्र वास्तविक भी है, मगर कहीं ना कहीं वो कथा भी है। और एक मुझे और बात जो बहुत जादुई लगी वो ये है कि आदमी की ज़िंदगी में सबसे महत्वपूर्ण चीज़ उसकी स्मृतियाँ होती हैं। अवर मेमरीज आर वॉट मेक अस, हम क्या हैं वो हमारी बचपन की यादें हैं, जवानी की यादें हैं, हमारे सपने हैं, हमारे संघर्षों की, हंसी खुशी की यादें हैं। इनके उपन्यास में हर पात्र के जो सपने हैं वो अलग अलग पीढ़ी के अपने अपने हैं, अपने परिवेश के हैं। कट्टरपंथी, ब्राह्मण, सनातनी भी उसमें है, एक दलित भी है, एक जो ब्राह्मण ईसाई बना था वो भी है जो जातिच्युत है, जो पढ़ने बाहर गया था जिसने शहर देखा वो भी है, एक ऐसा खांटी ब्राह्मण वैद्य है जो नेपाल में जाके बस जाता है और उसको धर्मच्युत नहीं मानते क्योंकि वो सागर पार नहीं गया, वहाँ उसने शादी भी कर ली है। कहीं विधवा एक है, फिर विधवा विवाह है, पति के अतिरिक्त प्रेम का प्रसंग है, ये लंबी कहानी है। मगर जहाँ वो दोनों धाराएं मिलती हैं, त्रिदीप भाई ने जो सरस्वती चंद्र नामक उपन्यास लिखा है, हम लोगों के लिए, अधिकांश लोगों के लिए उत्तर भारत में जो गुजरात के साहित्यिक इतिहास से परिचित नहीं है, सरस्वती चंद्र एक फिल्म है और उस फिल्म के बहाने हम इसको समझते हैं। मगर जो चीज़ें समानांतर हैं, थिंग्स नॉट टू बी लेफ्ट बिहाइंड और सरस्वती चंद्र में, आधुनिकता का और परंपरा का संघर्ष है। देर इज अ कॉन्स्टेंट टेंशन बिटवीन ट्रेडिशन एंड मॉडर्निटी। देर ऑल्सो इज एन इम्पैक्ट ऑफ नेशनल मूवमेंट ऑन कॉमन पीपल। कहीं ये नहीं कहती कि ऐसा आंदोलन हुआ उसका प्रभाव उसकी जीवन में ये पड़ा, मगर रेल के सफर में हिंदुस्तानी आदमी को नस्लवाद का, भेदभाव का सामना करना पड़ा। बंबई गया, जिस चाल में वो रहता था वहाँ उसने क्या खाया, किसके साथ क्या किया, उसके आधार पर घर में उसके साथ क्या सुलूक हुआ, क्या उसके घर में खाना पकता था, पारंपरिक खाना क्या था, हरे पालक का कफा था, बबुई की रोटी थी, घी था, गहत की दाल थी। तो आई विल मच रादर लाइक टू पास इट ऑन टू नमिता, नो बिफोर दैट, बिफोर वी गो टू त्रिदीप, कि वुड शी लाइक टू डिवेलप सम ऑफ द थीम्स विच शी हैज जस्ट टच्ड, क्योंकि ये इनकी ट्रायोलॉजी की एक पुस्तक है। तो आई वुड लाइक वेदर बुक वुड कम आउट ऑफ दिस, वेदर अ मोर हिस्टोरिकल थिंग वुड कम आउट ऑफ दिस, और वुड यू फॉलो इट अप विद अ सीक्वल।
कैन यू हियर मी? सो डियर फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज गोइंग टू बी अ ट्राइलिंगुअल और एटलीस्ट अ बाइलिंगुअल कन्वर्सेशन। मेरी हिंदी अच्छी है मगर पुष्पेश की तरह इतनी बढ़िया नहीं है, ना मुझे गुजराती आती है, और जो मेरी किताब है इट्स रिटन इन इंग्लिश बट आई ऑल्सो पब्लिश इन हिंदी एंड इन द इंडियन लैंग्वेजेस, एंड इट इज़ माई 14th बुक इन इंग्लिश एंड इट इज़ माई 3rd बुक सेट इन द कुमाऊँ हिल्स। नाउ आई एम अ कुमाऊनी फ्रॉम नैनीताल, आई वॉज अ पंत बिफोर आई बिकेम अ गोखले, एंड वॉट इज 3 ऑफ माई बुक्स of fiction and 2 of my books of non-fiction have been about Kumaoni women. And the reason why so much of my fiction is about Kumaoni women is because I found they are unlike the women in the rest of India. That sounds like a very sweeping statement, but for various reasons, the strength of Kumaoni women has not been compromised completely by society as it has in the rest of India. In the rest of India, the women are very, very strong, but socially they are very vulnerable. But in Kumaon, it is somewhat different. We in the hills, across the hills, not only in Kumaon, but I find it in Nepal or in Bhutan, the women are not told to modulate their strength or to suppress their strength. And this almost savage strength of Kumaoni women, which shocks and startles people who are not used to their very direct approach to life, really came to me when I did a book about 20 years ago. It was a book of oral biographies of my grandmother and 3 of my aunts, and about their memories and the memories of their mothers. And that became the material for this new book called Things to Leave Behind. Things to Leave Behind follows, as Pushpesh said, 3 generations of women in the hills, well, 2.5. And the one character in this book called Tilottama has almost taken over the book. You know, sometimes you have a character who becomes the most dominant. But what I've tried to show in this book and why there are so many resonances with Saraswati Chandra or other books of that time is because my book documents from 1840 to 1912 the changes that were taking place in India in the lives not only of women but of men, of the British Empire, of everything. These days when we live in the 2016, end of 2016, we just had a session where it was about social media and radio. See, we are constantly overtaken by change and surprised by the change around us. But we forget that life is always changing. And when you read my novel, you find out that in 1840 to 1912, people were as puzzled by what they thought were modern times. Because that was a period which got so much change. It had the railways, it had the first aeroplanes, it had a postal service. You had Charles Darwin talking about people in becoming, descending from monkeys. So these are moments of change, and that really is the joy of writing novels and fiction, that you understand our times, other times, and things like that. So I won't go on and on about my book. There are a few samplers of my book available for free also in the bookshop, I think. You can get a look of it. But I would love to ask you, sir, about your book, your translation. And in my book, what you thought were the resonances between those times?
Thank you, Namita. And we have to drop the sir. You know, what you leave behind is actually the family. And unless you leave behind the family, this encounter with modernity does not happen. And what Saraswati Chandra has to do, the first act almost, is to leave the family. And that's the way you encounter the world, that's the way you encounter yourself. So this coming face to face with yourself, and which is what Tilottama does, which is what even Jayesh, the character who moves to Bombay, transgresses does. So Bombay as a place of allurement, of allowing you to transgress, allowing you to leave behind caste, leave behind taboos. So in parts the novel, Saraswati Chandra is based in novel. But what he has to do is to leave Bombay and family behind to go look for what he thought was in there. So there is that. But I think fascinatingly, two things which your novel begins with. One is the presence of 1857. And of course the presence was very different in Western India as it was from the hills. Western India in strange ways, given the proximity, even given the proximity to Bombay or Nagpur, did not really experience the kind of upheaval, the cultural upheaval that the hills go through. Largely because the British men and women and the missionaries and the institutions move upward and not westward. So there is a different kind of thing that we experienced with 1857. But the churning in the native states, to which you allude, and the kind of imprisonment, also hanging, martyrdom kind of issues also dominate the third part of the novel. It's the women which really make both stories. Tilottama in your case, Gunasundari, Kusum, Kumud, Alakishori, and in case of Saraswati Chandra. Because what clearly bears out from that is that the burden of transition, or even the drama of transition, is actually most acutely felt in the domestic space. And if it's acutely felt in the domestic space, then the women become both the bearers of that change and also bear the burden of that change. So I think in that sense, both share a very large sensibility.
That's absolutely fascinating, because my book got blurbs from, among others, the great feminist Gloria Steinem. Here is just the beginning of her quote, but her long quote was very interesting. She said, "The burdens of caste, not only the burdens of caste, but the burdens of class by extension, or of race, these are meant by women to be perpetuated. So the burden of that imprisonment comes to women, because it is to them and their sense of family that strict hierarchies have to be passed on." So a book about women who break out of it, it's not a feminist book in any sense of the word. It's a book about women who find themselves. And the family, I agree, whether it is in Saraswati Chandra or in my book or in so many other books, and the women is the core of the story. And in that sense, Saraswati Chandra is not a patriarchal, male-dominated story. It is a woman-dominated story. And that is what is most interesting to me.
What I would like to chip in is, when we are discussing the book somewhere else, another point you made is very interesting, because I think there is family part, which is important, that you leave the family and encounter the world, and that's the beginning of modernity, beginning of alienation. But there also is a lifelong yearning to belong somewhere, to look for your roots and to have a family. And you said something, I think Abbotsford it was, when you said, this book is also very much about love. People fall in love, man falls in love, they fall out of love, maybe they fall in love with somebody else, they fall in love again, maybe with the same person. And this thread of love is always running through the narrative. So is this love makes you redeem yourself, this love may make you transgress from things. How does that fit in with the concept of modernity? Because in the sense, it was not as if in traditional joint family system there was no space for love.
I edited another book, and this book was called Walking to Ourselves. It was about women's stories from across India. And I think so many women I know lack that final step to become themselves, because society has many more rules for women than they do for men in any and every situation. And the human heart and the need for freedom within human beings is something which nobody can really leave behind. So I think love and freedom are the two things that carry through whatever the history is, wherever in the world you are. It could be in a prison, it could be in a palace, but freedom and love are what define the human needs.
Tridip, would you say that there is a streak of the same in Saraswati Chandra as well, where there's a love between individuals, not necessarily Colonel, but which also provides the glue to the narrative?
You know, it's actually held together by various love stories. And there are five love stories. I mean, so it's actually, you could actually reduce the novel to either one love story or five. In that sense, what the novel seeks to do is to take this idea of the woman-man relationship and place it on a much very wide scale. It's not seeking to foreground it, but there is no other literary device available to the author, and so love becomes a kind of a foregrounding metaphor. But it's not actually. It's a reflection on dharma. It's a reflection on politics. It's a reflection on the nature of conjugality itself. It's also a reflection on nature of change. And interestingly, it's the first major utopia that India produces, because it's actually looking into the future and saying, what does this idea of Kalyan Gram entail? And Kalyan Gram can only be in our, it can't be a place, it can't be a time, it can only be a vision, could be an aspiration. So love there is a very interesting literary device. But of course it has its moments, as love always does. And so.
Do you think, two questions at the same time. Do you think there could be some resonances between the Eden Ashram in my novel and Kalyan Gram as sort of utopias of some kind? Secondly, I want to know, in Gujarat, how much is Saraswati Chandra still read and appreciated by the younger generation? Do they know it, or they know it as a textbook?
The second question I can't answer. I don't really know. It's part of the literary canon. So when you study Gujarati language and Gujarati literature, there is no way you can escape it. How much of it is studied and how much of the text is quote-unquote compulsory reading, I am not aware of it. But I think the illusions or the presence of Saraswati Chandra or Govardhan Ram is very much present in the cultural milieu. And that's the sense.
Can
that
we ask the audience?
Please do.
I want to know in the audience, how many of you have, everybody has heard of Saraswati Chandra, how many of you have actually read Saraswati Chandra out of choice? That's not a lot. Let me count all the hands. Please, hands up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 people in the audience. I'm very, since I'm a literature festival director, I've already counted the audience. There are about 60 people in the audience, 10 out of 60. I would have expected more in Gujarat. But you know, in my experience, 11. what happens in my experience is that any literature that becomes sort of compulsory, not by the law or by any government, but by just the academic institutions, loses its luster. And I think we are all missing out on a beautiful piece of fiction which is so situated, and next time we should have a session on Saraswati Chandra here. And make it compulsory. Not we can't make it. What are your views on this?
No, Namita, taking off from what Tridip bhai said, talking about utopias and Kalyan Gram and your Eden Ashram and so on, I was, you know, in this story also there are very interesting encounters. Tirotama has an encounter with Swami Vivekananda. And Swami Vivekananda is also having a dream of modern India, muscular Hinduism, strong India, etc. She also is aware of what Gandhi Baba is doing down in the plains. He hasn't come as yet. But Gandhi is not even a distant blip on the radar at the moment. He hasn't even come from...
He hasn't even landed yet.
He hasn't come. But there is a freedom struggle. People are talking about things. So when this kid comes from Bombay, he has seen the world outside Jaish. So I was wondering, would you like to share your perceptions of Tilottama's encounter with this young Swamiji?
So friends, I'm going to read a small passage, very, very short passage from my book to give you a taste of this book. So as I said, there is this character called Tilottama. She's from a very traditional family. Her mother has drowned in the Nainital Lake, committed suicide maybe because she's a widow. Her father's younger brother has been hung and martyred during the mutiny. Now she is married and living in Almora, and she is not traditional. She does what she likes and it always shocks people around her. So it's a short passage about the visit of Swami Vivekananda to Almora. And this actually happened. The everything in the story except Tilottama's reactions are from history. It was not just the men who were reading strange books and behaving strangely. There was Tilottama, opening out with delight and wonder to the new world, the new century that was just around the corner. She read the news and views printed in the local newspaper, the Almora Akhbar, regularly and conscientiously. The books she borrowed from the local library and bought from the English bookshop imparted an exhilarating sense of the changes that were taking place across India and the world. There is so much to be discovered, she thought wistfully. So much to be seen and heard and experienced, but not for me. Religious ways seem to be changing too. A tall, well-built, English-speaking, cigar-smoking monk, dressed in orange robes and turban, with an imposing gait and personality, had arrived in Almora for the summer months. Swami Vivekananda was a follower of Swami Ramakrishna. He was lodged in Oakley House, the guest of Lala Harisha. Almora was blessed by his visit, and even the women folk were allowed to go and hear his discourses. Tilottama decided to observe Swami Vivekananda at first hand. She sat quietly in the last row among the assembled disciples. He had a magnetic presence, and his aura spread and settled across the room. His eyes held her, his eyes and the faint fragrance that trailed after him as he entered the room. Skepticism. She could well imagine herself becoming this man's disciple. Each soul is potentially divine, he began. Manifest your divinity by work or worship, mental discipline or philosophy, and be free. Go forth without a path, fearing nothing, caring for nothing, wandering alone like the rhinoceros. Even as a lion, not trembling at noises, even as the wind, not caught in the net, even as the lotus leaf, untainted by water, do thou wander alone like the rhinoceros. Tilottama was listening intently. What is the definition of freedom, she asked Swami Vivekananda. Would I be allowed to chew tobacco if I became your disciple? She continued, or to smoke cigars? The congregation was shocked by her question, but the Swami took it in his stride. Tobacco is an evil, he replied, giving her his thoughtful scrutiny. I'm human like you and have to wrestle with my faults. I suffer from lumbago for my sins and asthma. Would you encourage or allow your child, your son or daughter, to chew tobacco? Ask yourself that question. "Thank God you are not God," Tilottama replied. The response was sincere and heartfelt, and the irreverence and unsuitability of her reply hit home only when she heard the gasps and shocked silence from the rest of the pious audience. "Arise, ye mighty, and be strong. Work on and on, struggle on and on," Swami Vivekananda responded. His eyes met hers, and she could glimpse the laughter in them. So that is about how, you know, in our times, so many people in the recent past who were intensely human, be it Gandhi, be it Sardar Patel, be it Swami Vivekananda, they were humans like us. But the tendency in India, and which is what I've tried to break in my novel, not in a subversive way, but just in a normal way, that the tendency is that those times were like our times. Those people, 150 years ago, the people were just like us. There's no difference. History changes, historical situations change, governments change, so the social hierarchies change. People remain the same. And the greatest men have the greatest weaknesses. Just like Swami Vivekananda, if today we were to tell certain people that yes, Swami Vivekananda was addicted to cigars, they would say, "Don't talk anti-national or something," you know, it would become, because we are all human somewhere, and the humanity is what novels and fiction can show us, our shared humanity.
This tempts me to ask you a question. You also have a list of strange books which not only men but women were reading, some in English, some in Hindi, some traditional mythology, some Gita Pras Gurakpur Kalyan type, some Garuda Puran type, and there is a very fair sprinkling in your book. They come here and there. What is the significance of those books? Do you find them as a perennial literature for Pahari Brahmin families, or do you think those books have greater significance?
You know, we have a scattered audience, you are all sitting around, but I think you will all find it interesting to think about a woman character who is living, say, in the end of the, somewhere around 1870, 1890, 1890, 2000, sorry, whatever the years, however, 1820, you know, around the end of these 1870s, 1880s. She is learning to read. She is illiterate. And first she learns to read in Hindi. And then she learns to read in English. And she discovers the world of books. And through the changes in those books, she and the people around her change. And we forget how much of social change in the world comes about from the books we read. So these are the books. Later I made out a list of the books that are mentioned in my novel, Things to Leave Behind. The first book that is mentioned is the Manaskand from the Skand Puran, because Kumau was mentioned in the Manaskand and Garhwal was as known as the Kedarkand. So that was in the beginning. Then there was this incredible book called the Himalayan Gazetteer. It was in 18 or 22 volumes, and the British administrators put together the history and geography of the entire Himalayan ranges, and it's still in use in all the universities. Similarly, the British, you know, the British took notes wherever they went. So there are these books I've mentioned, Kumau, Geology and Natural Science, McKellent, which was somewhere in 1837 published, Himalayan Journals, Notes of a Naturalist, again published 1837, 1838. Thanks to the internet, we can discover many of these books in their digital forms. There was a book called Wandering in the Himalaya, by Pilgrim P. Baron, who built the first house in Nainital. And this book is still very much in circulation around the hills these days. Then I found there were these newspaper articles in the Illustrated London News, in Ladies' Newspaper and Pictorial Times about the mutiny. And then there was Karl Marx, or about the First War of Independence, if you prefer, from today's point of view. Karl Marx in the New York Daily Tribune wrote about this. And he was most critical of the way the British were using the propaganda. And he said as much of the savagery was done by the British rulers. Then there were these papers, there was something called the Almora Akhbar, which one of my ancestors, actually my great-grandfather, had started. Then there was the weekly Bande Mataram, edited by Sri Aurobindo. Then I've talked about the Garuda Puran, about the Shiv Tandav Stotra, the Bible. Then there was somebody called Bishop Heber, who had a very important part to play in publishing and the history of translation in India, because out of Pondicherry, he translated into the Bible into almost every language in India, including Kumaoni and Garhwali. And he also published and printed these books and set up a printing press. Then there was the book that has made the most impact on my character, Tilottama, which was Pandit Ramabai's book, The High Caste Hindu Woman. And it's impossible today to think what a storm this book caused at that time. And she, in fact, financed a trip to America with the proceeds and sales of the book. Then there was The Voyage of the Beagle and The Origin of Species by Charles Darwin. There were Plain Tales from the Hills by Rudyard Kipling. There was the most wonderful book of those days, the bestseller, Chandrakanta by Devaki Nandan Khatri. I'm going to do another test. How many of you have heard of, if not read, Chandrakanta by Devaki Nandan Khatri? More. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. Well, better than Saraswati Chandra. What a fantastic book Chandrakanta is. It's magical, and I wish all of us here had read it. Then there was a great Bengali writer called Michael Madhusudan Dutt. Hands up again, how many of you heard of Michael Madhusudan Dutt? Okay, not bad for Gujarat, considering he's a not so well-known Bangla writer. There was Little Women by Louisa May Alcott, which influenced those days. There was this great Nightingale of India, Sarojini Naidu. And there were all these books, you know, there were homeopathy books, there were books like that. If I was writing the book today, I would have made her read Saraswati Chandra. That would have made an impact.
I would like to take the question to you, Tridip bhai. The problem is that she mentions a whole lot of books. They fall into, to my mind, three broad categories. There are gazetteers printed in English, which Tilottama, after laboriously educating herself from Hindi to English, has access to. There are books on Materia Medica. There are books which give her a window to the wider world, where she can't travel, not even like Jai. There's one set of books. There's another set of books which may be falling into the category of religious scriptures, mythologicals, Garuda Purana, Shivtandava Stotra, but which is not something which is accessible to a high caste Brahmin in Hales or anywhere else. But this is part of a recitation of Bhagavad or Ramayana or something. There is a third category of books which she has, which would be considered subversive then, which were pure entertainment, like Devaki Nandan Khatri's Chandrakanta, Chandrakanta Santati. Now, it takes me back to the very opening of her novel, where three dark dressed women are circulating around the lake, and they are supposed to be Dakini, and an ill omen is there, and so on. Now, there is in this book, there is an extremely interesting resonance, reverberance, if I may say so, of the supernatural, mythological, occult, exotic, which is not superstition in that sense, but it is something which is in our blood. So you say you can't get rid of folklore. You say this is the same. And that is what I meant when my problem with the family issue is this, that we have memories of an individual. We have shared family memories of the family. We have a tradition in the family, and we have a tradition in the community. You have a city, a glorious city like Ahmedabad, which had a character. And when you destroy something like Wali Dahlani's Mazar, a bit of that inheritance is lost. Last time I remember we were driving past the Marine Drive, and if you dig up the roadside to wreck something like the view from Darpan, the Sarabhai is aboard, you also erode and chip away at the cultural heritage of this place. There is a gentleman whose pictorial work is there, the creations, but then what about the Purani city? The place I'm staying is a fabulous Haveli. So I wanted to ask you the question that how much of what we make of our context, the environs, is a function of what we gather firsthand, and how much of what we shape our lives and decide to make a mess of it or redeem ourselves is the books we read. And isn't there, in, like in the case of Virottama, a very interesting sangam takes place from Gazetteer to London Illustrated News to Chandrakanta to Garudapona. And you somehow make sense of everything to decide your Western song and your philosophy of life. In Saraswati Chandra, is there a similar reference to books which the protagonists have access to and which you might say, I'm surprised that she has two very interesting things like Materia Medica and Karl Marx reporting there. I mean, which would be cutting edge, bleeding edge reportage there. So, how does it occur there?
In a stream, not across the 19th century, early 20th century, your encounter with modernity for women was through books. So men traveled and women read books. I think that's, I mean, I'm trivializing, but it's a large trope, right? It's a large trope of the 19th, 20th century. And so books play a very important role in all works of the 19th century, because if you have to show a new kind of modernity, a new kind of cultivation, how do you do it? What's fascinating, and that's something that we haven't really spoken about Tilottama, is a fascination with scientific instrument called the barometer. Right? And what captivated me about that woman was the barometer, because your encounter with instrumentality of that kind within the domestic sphere was a rare occurrence. Books came into our homes, but the scientific instruments rarely did, because it was part of something which was not. So for me, that was, you know, a great delight to see that. A different kind of, you know, Saraswati Chandra tries to give to you a glimpse of both, a different kind of literary sensibilities which become available to you through Sanskrit at one level, through modern Gujarati at another level, and you know, the entry of the English, not as people, but as sensibility. Because the English men and women don't populate the novel the same extent, with the same intensity as her work does. But the sensibility does. So, and it's really a literary sensibility, it's an aesthetic sensibility. You begin to see changes occurring. For example, the walls begin to have a photograph. Very 19th century or very early 20th century, before that you never, one that you didn't have photography, but you never put up anything which was framed.
Or a Raja Ravi Verma
or
print,
a Raja
which
Ravi
is also
or
part of
my
novel.
Yeah, which is, you know, and Baroda happens and that's something that Saraswati Chandra shares. What's also interesting is a lot of the women in fact, almost all the women in Saraswati Chandra compose poetry in different meters, in different ways, with different sensibilities. So from a garbo or a garbi to a completely modern love song, and since fortunately Govardhan Ram was not very well versed in the use of meter, this would also break the rules of meter. So you have so that their exposure to a new kind of sensibility, new kind of articulation is evident throughout, and that comes through literature. While men quote Sanskrit verses, women compose their own poetry, which is so much better.
That's really one of the joys of literature festivals, that here the Gujarat Literature Festival has brought together three very different people, and I never thought I'd be able to think, not a good sentence, I never expected to encounter Saraswati Chandra as a balance to my book in my exploration for modernity and the contemporary exploration of modernity in that book, and I'm going to go back, read your translation again and write something about it. But it has been so thought-provoking. Very, you know, we are all here to enjoy the joys of these literary verbal encounters. But books just are the biggest catalysts and the biggest changes in the world, and they do it quietly, and they are the most subversive creatures in the world. And we know why so many people fear them.
Permit me to ask you one more subversive question. I know Tilotama is very dear to your heart, and Tilotama is the central to the novel, but there are other characters, and I feel drawn towards them also. There are two issues which I find in your book particularly sensitive. One is that when the conversion takes place and the Eden ashram is there, it is not idyllic, it is not utopian. Social disparities exist there also. There is a sweeper's colony where Lal Maharaj is there. The local scheduled caste converted to Christianity, which remain at the bottom of the heap. They have lost caste, they are not in the Hinduism, but they are not quite equal. There is a racial discrimination, and the small affair, fleeting affair, which takes place between this painter and this young Indian girl, also has a nuanced portrayal of a relationship which may scar you for life, which may create scar tissue for life, and which gives meaning to whatever has gone before. So there is a painting and which is changed. I wish life were so easy to sort of redo a painting, but I think that is where a metaphor you bring, which again is very tantalizing, because is a minor character, but the minor character is an offspring in a long chain. So she, in a sense, is inheriting so many contradictions, so many dreams, but so many possibilities with the passage of time has come.
You know, this book is called Things to Leave Behind. And in that title, I was trying to talk about the things we leave behind, because all of us have to move on. Modernity, or every time modernity is changing, today's modernity is different from last year's modernity. But unless we look to the future, we can't move on. At the same time, it's very important to keep a sense of what are we going to leave behind. Because it's about the things we have to move on from and the things which are our karmic legacy to leave behind. And I can't talk much more about the novel. I do hope that all of you some way or the other get to read it. And I hope that either you or I or one of us or both of us write a piece about Saraswati Chandra and this. But maybe if there are any questions in the audience, we would love to get them. If there are not, we'll ask each other some more questions. Because I think we have another 10 minutes? 5 minutes? 5 minutes, okay. Can we take a mic there, or will you just get up and ask the question?
हिंदी चलेगा ना? हमारे यहाँ एक ट्रेडिशन होती है कि किसी को हम जल्दी से भगवान बना देते हैं, और तिलोत्तमा का जो पात्र आपने बताया, जो आपने एक्सेप्ट अभी जो आपने पढ़ा, उसमें ये बताया कि थैंक गॉड यू आर नॉट ए गॉड. दिस इज द मोस्ट फैसिनेटिंग लाइन टू रीड योर बुक. इज देयर एनी अनदर थिंग
थ्रू आउट द बुक? इट्स लाइक दिस ओनली दैट बिकॉज तिलोत्तमा एज अ कैरेक्टर इज वेरी इंडिपेंडेंट माइंडेड. And also, as he pointed out, her husband is a scientist. So she is also encouraged just to think about things anew. And throughout the book, I'm trying to get people to look at things for the first time and to make their own reactions. Not the reactions that are given to us by other people, by conditioning, other people's conditioning, other people's prejudice. How few of us actually think on our own? All of us are thinking other people's thoughts. Even now in the age of social media, even more so. So, Tilottama is one character who I think everybody loves her so much, because good or bad, however awkward, she thinks for herself. Now you'll have to read the book and come up with other lines, because I can't remember straight away. Are there any more questions here? Yeah, can you take the mic there? Could you give me your name as well? It's always nice to know.
Myself Radhika.
Okay.
From Rajkot. I would like to ask that if any researcher will plan to research or compare Tilottama and Kumud Sundari, what may be the comparing grounds or contrasting grounds?
I think that's a wonderful idea, but you will have to give that reply more than me. And I hope we see a research project.
No, I think, you know, what's important when you look at 19th century is the idea of newness. what's really gone out from our lives in the 21st century is the idea of newness and uniqueness. You remember the first time you saw a white person. You remember the first time you saw a beef eater. And for these women, these are life-altering. So whether it's for Kumud or for Tilottama, the life actually is a novel in the sense a novel katha is. It's a story of the new. And I think what resonates between the two works and my fondness for the two women characters there, three in fact, is really because they experience the idea of the novel every day. Look at the fact that she's perhaps the first woman in the entire hills to be able to read an English script. And that's something that we don't find, you and I would not find that as a life-altering experience, not only for you and me, but for the community. She's the first woman, actually, who dresses up as a man, without a shirt. She actually has worn only a pair of trousers and a jacket and a hat, right? She smokes a cigar. Now, I'm not suggesting, these are all markers of modernity and uniqueness. So when you look at Kumud, you realize that this is something that has not happened before. Each of these experiences, be them those of Tilottama or Kumud, the entire act of being both married, uncertain of your widowhood or your marriage, you are uncertain between widowhood, being grihasthi and being asceticism. These are three different stages of life. You've been experiencing that within a span of 7 days. Now, that I think, so, you know, it's not about the two women, it's about the 19th century. The mid to late 19th century, early 20th century, you read any literature, which or look at any lives, be the life of Kasturba, right? She was the first woman to sail out from her community and cross the seas. What did it mean? First time you encounter Katluli, what does this mean? So I think the uniqueness is what binds the characters, the women, and as they say, the Abohava.
It's a fascinating thing, we are out of time, but I'd like to add just one short comment before we go from the stage, which is that the inspiration for this character in part came from this book where I recorded the oral memories of my grandmother and three aunts. One of them was a relative of mine called Tara Pandey. She was a great poetess of Kumaon, and she wrote in this biography about how when she was 11 years old, she was married, and her uncle took her around Almora, saying this is the last time you'll ever be able to see these streets. Because after she was married, she could only wear, for some reason, they could only walk barefoot. She couldn't wear shoes after that. And it's cold in the hills, you'll only walk barefoot, and you can only go by the inner lanes. You can't go to the main road. And then she got tuberculosis. She went to a tuberculosis sanatorium where she wrote poetry, won an award, was photographed. Her uncle tore up the photograph and broke up the camera. After that, Gandhiji came, and when she came out of the tuberculosis sanatorium, it was a different world. So I'm so glad you brought up this subject, and I hope somebody does it. On that note, will you say the thank yous?
Thank you.
But thank you to the Gujarat Literature Festival for giving me this most precious encounter. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, all the dignitaries, for being with us on stage. Next session, je ahiya shuruat thava jai rahyu che, TED Talks, je tame sambhalo chho, TEDx, ena pehla Hindi vakta, emni sathe ni mulakat che. Mara college na mitra che, etle emni sathe ni janeli vato, ane amuk evi vato, je kadash mane ane tamne khyal nathi. Evi vato apne janvano prayatna karishu. આપણામાંથી બહુ બધા લોકો એવું વિચારે છે કે યાર હિન્દી પુસ્તકો તો શું વાંચે, ઇંગ્લિશ ઇઝ વેરી કુલ, એટલે આપણે ગુજરાતી પુસ્તકો પણ વાંચવાનું ઓછું કરી નાખ્યું છે, અને હિન્દી ફિલ્મોમાં જેટલી રૂપાળી લાગે છે આપણને એટલી પુસ્તકોમાં નથી લાગતી. ધીસ ઇઝ વન પર્સન જેણે એ વિચાર બદલવાની કોશિશ કરી છે, હુ હેઝ ટ્રાઈડ ટુ ચેન્જ દેટ નોશન એન્ડ બ્યુટિફુલી સો. એની વાત કરીએ થોડી જ વારમાં. થેન્ક યુ.
Good evening. Okay. કનોરિયા સેન્ટરના ગેટ પાસે જેના પણ વેહિકલ્સ હોય, ટુ વ્હીલર, ફોર વ્હીલર, પ્લીઝ તમે લઈને ત્યાંથી બીજી જગ્યાએ મૂકી દેજો, કારણ કે થોડી જ વારમાં સીએમ સાહેબ અહીંયા આવી રહ્યા છે અને ટોઈંગ વેન પણ આવી ગઈ છે. જો તમારા વેહિકલ્સ ત્યાં હશે તો ત્યાંથી જતા રહેશે. એટલે ગેટ પાસે જેના પણ વેહિકલ્સ હોય એ પ્લીઝ ત્યાંથી લઈ લેજો. થેન્ક યુ. અને નેક્સ્ટ સેશન જે અહીંયા જવા થઈ રહ્યો છે એ ટેડેક્સના ફર્સ્ટ હિન્દી સ્પીકર જે છે આપણી સાથે અત્યારે. એટલે તમારા ફ્રેન્ડ્સ, તમારા સિવાય જેને કોઈને ઇન્ટરેસ્ટ હોય એને તમારે બોલાવવા, એને બોલાવી શકો અત્યારે. વૈસે તો અમે ઝ્યાદાતર હિન્દી બુક્સ હમ પઢતે નહીં હૈ, ક્યુંકિ હમે લગતા હૈ કે યે ભારી ભરકમ બુક જો હિન્દી હોતી હૈ વો હમે સમજ મે નહીં આઈ. હમારી હિન્દી સિર્ફ હિન્દી મૂવી યા ફિર સિરિયલ્સ તક હી હૈ કે હા યહી અચ્છી હૈ. ઓર બુક્સ વાલી જો હિન્દી હૈ યાર.